सहकार विश्व ह्या बॅनर ह्या चॅनल वरती आपले रेकॉर्डेड प्रोग्राम सगळ्यांना बघायला मिळतील. त्याच्यानंतर आपण क्रेडिट सोसायटी वरती एक प्रोग्राम केला. क्रेडिट सोसायटी वरती आपण प्रोग्राम केला, ऑडिट ऑफ क्रेडिट सोसायटी, झायरॅक नॉर्म्स आणि कॅमल्स रेटिंग. आणि सीए सुनील नागावकर ऑल द वे अगेन फ्रॉम कोल्हापूर, ही वॉज अवर फॅकल्टी, इज ऑल्सो अवर सिनियर फॅकल्टी अँड मेंबर ऑफ कोऑपरेटिव्ह कमिटी ऑफ WRC. आजच्या सेशनला ते पण आहेत. त्याच्यानंतर आपण एक अर्बन कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक वरती पण केला, ऑडिट आणि रिपोर्टिंग नॉर्म्स आणि RBI एक्सपोजर नॉर्म्स. आणि आपल्याकडे तेव्हा फॅकल्टी होते आपले डी ए चौगुले सर, अगेन सिनियर फॅकल्टी अगेन फ्रॉम दी कोल्हापूर, कारण कोऑपरेटिव्ह म्हटलं की कोल्हापूर लिडिंग स्टेट आहे. त्यामुळे डी ए चौगुले सरांनी मागचं सेशन आता हँडल केलेलं आहे. आणि मी म्हटलं की आता एक GST वरती पण WRC लेवलला, कारण आय एम कोऑपरेटिव्ह कमिटी चेअरपर्सन WRC, तर WRC ला आपण GST ऑन कोऑपरेटिव्ह क्रेडिट सोसायटी बँक आणि हाऊसिंग सोसायटीचं एक घेतलं. बट WRC ला आपल्याला थोडा चॅलेंज आहे, बिकॉज मॅक्झिमम 10 CPE इव्हेंट्स आपण एका महिन्यामध्ये करू शकतो. त्याच्यामुळे बॅक टू बॅक कोऑपरेटिव्हचे प्रोग्राम्स होणं तसं डिफिकल्ट आहे. सो आय थॉट आपण GST केलेलं आहे, ऑडिट्स आपण घेतलेलं आहे, हाऊसिंग झालंय, क्रेडिट झाले, अर्बन कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक झालं, तर एक टॅक्सेशनचं पण जर सेमिनार घेतलं तर एक पॅकेज दिल्यासारखं होईल कोऑपरेटिव्ह प्रॅक्टिशनर्सना. आणि जे अमेंडमेंट्स आहेत आता कोऑपरेटिव्ह म्हणजे बजेटमधल्या ज्या अमेंडमेंट्स आहेत, सेक्शन 194A चं जे अमेंडमेंट आहे, त्याचे मला भरपूर कॉल्स मेसेजेस आणि हे येत आहेत. काही सिनियर CAs पण फोन करून क्लॅरिफिकेशन विचारत आहेत. तर ते एक सेक्शन आहे जे आपल्याला we have to look into. And then another is like amendment in the recent budget about the rate of taxation and introduction of 115BAD section, so that is also we have to touch upon. And credit society and urban cooperative banks as it is, it's like Pandora box. Tumhala kai jevda tumhi vicharal kiwa apan bagayla jau tevda tyacha madhe aplyala khajana sarka ahe. Tumhala bares issues pan ahet ani bares case laws ahet. And disallowance of ATP is again always a sub matter of discussion and debate. So I thought it's better we line up this session. And thank you Sanjay Vanbatte sir, tumhi kay mhantat lages ho mhanalat ani aajcha session mhanala. So thank you so much. I also welcome Nagnath Basude sir. He is expert director on Varna Sahkari Bank and I am also expert director on Varna Sahkari Bank. So sir, tumcha swagat ahe. काही सिनियर सी आहेत, कासट सर आहेत, अनिल पिंपरखेडे आहेत आपल्याकडे, आमची कोऑपरेटिव्ह स्टडी ग्रुपची कन्व्हिनर अमृता जोशी आहे, बसवराज शास्त्री सर आहेत सोलापूर वरून, जयेश शेठ सर आहेत आमचे, आणि असे बरेच दिसत आहेत. हा प्रसाद मोड आहेत, राजीव पेटकर म्हणून माझा नेबर आहे, मी तिथे राहते मुंबईमध्ये, तर माझं बिल्डिंग मध्येच आहे अँड ही इज ऑल्सो कोऑपरेटिव्ह प्रॅक्टिशनर, सिनियर कोऑपरेटिव्ह प्रॅक्टिशनर. सो राजीव तुझं पण स्वागत आहे. आणि ऑफकोर्स सगळेच सिनियर्स आणि ज्यांनी ज्यांनी जॉईन केलं आणि पीपल विल जॉईन, कारण बरेच रजिस्ट्रेशन आहेत. तर क्वेश्चन्स मला मेल वरती आलेले आहेत सर, तर आपण काय करूया, तुम्ही तुमचं आधी प्रेझेंटेशन द्या आणि मे बी शेवटचे 15 मिनिट आपण क्वेश्चन आन्सर साठी ठेवूया अँड दॅट आय विल मॉडरेट. हा आणि मी सगळ्यांना थोडस चॅट मोड पण मी चॅट विथ मी ऍज अ होस्ट आणि अशा प्रकारे आपण थोडस करूया. सो नाऊ इट्स ओव्हर टू यू अँड बिफोर दॅट येस एव्हरीबडी प्लीज विजिट माय युट्यूब चॅनल सहकार विश्व, ज्याच्यावरती तुम्हाला 40+ व्हिडिओज आहेत कोऑपरेटिव्ह रिलेटेड आणि तुमचे सगळे डाऊट्स त्याच्यावरती क्लिअर होतील. आणि नवीन ऑडिट फॉर्म रिलेटेड पण मला क्वेरीज येतात की फॉर्म्स कुठे मिळतील, तर WRCच्या आपल्या वेबसाईट वरती कोऑपरेटिव्ह सेक्शन आहे ते ओल्ड म्हणून, कारण मागच्या वर्षी WRCची वेबसाईट आपण अपडेट केलेली आहे, तर कोऑपरेटिव्ह सेक्शन आता ओल्ड वेबसाईट मध्ये येतं. तर तुम्हाला पाहिजे तर मी लिंक नंतर पाठवेन, पण सगळे फॉर्म्स किंवा जे सर्क्युलर्स नोटिफिकेशन आहेत ते तुम्हाला WRCच्या वेबसाईट वरती पण मिळतील, रिप्रेझेंटेशन पण मिळतील. आणि माझी जी वेबसाईट आहे CA शिल्पा शिंगारे.in, तिथे पण तुम्हाला भरपूर रिसोर्स मटेरियल आहे. तर रिसोर्स मटेरियल टॅब वरती जर तुम्ही क्लिक केलं तर तिकडे तुम्हाला बऱ्यापैकी रिसोर्स मटेरियल अवेलेबल आहे, कोऑपरेटिव्हचं आहे, रेराचं आहे, टॅक्सेशन केस लॉज वगैरे आहेत. तर आय वुड रिक्वेस्ट एव्हरीबडी टू विजिट WRC वेबसाईट कोऑपरेटिव्ह सेक्शन अँड दे कॅन विजिट माय वेबसाईट ऑल्सो. Right. Now, I once again welcome Sanjay Vanbatte sir, our senior faculty all the way from Kolhapur sir. Sir, over to you. You can start your presentation. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Shingare madam, thank you for the opportunity. I am audible?
Yes sir, you are audible.
And my screen is properly shared?
Yes sir. properly shared, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so we can continue. Yes. So I start with thanking Shingara Madam for giving me this opportunity. This is a webinar on cooperative taxations. Particularly, I'll be covering the cooperative bank income tax issues and cooperative credit societies income tax issues. But before I actually start for the webinar, it would be very necessary for all of us to first pay tribute to the 20 martyrs who lost their life on the Ladakh border. So I have this picture in front of all of us. We pay the tribute, we pay our heartiest tribute to all these people who have lost their life for the country. And with this starting, we proceed with the webinar. I hope you all agree with me for giving our salute to this martyrs. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I'll be starting with the little basics, and then whatever the issues are there, I have tried to deal with them. Ekdam detail madhe mi cover karayacha prayatna kelay. Ani shevti sagalyat kahi prashna vagere asel tar apan nakkis kevya kay problem nahi. First, let us see. Income tax madhe person chi je definition ahe, which is there in section 231. It does not contain a category as cooperative society. Only we have AOP as a category, and therefore cooperative societies basically fall in the category of a person, and therefore we have ITR 5 as the common form of return, which is available for firms, AOPs and body of individuals. But every finance act has a specific separate structure for cooperative societies, and there is a definition of cooperative society in section 219 of the Income Tax Act, which says that cooperative society is a society which is registered under the Cooperative Societies 1912 Act, which is a central act, or any other state act. All of us must be aware of this track structure, 10%, 20% and 30%, basically above 20,000 it is 30%. Education cesses for this year 4% and surcharge of 12% from the next year. So with this basics, now we take the first amendment which has come in the Finance Act 2020. Section 115BAD, we have 3-4 sections which are come in. Initially we are 115BAA, then BAB and BAC, BAA. All these sections give specific income tax rates, concessional income tax rates to the companies. If you can recollect, 115BAC is for the individual who have to forego lot many exemption, and then they can go for that 5%, 10%, 15% and that kind of slab for the income tax structure. In this line is 115BAD, which is a section for the cooperative societies. It's prescribes a reduced tax rate of 22% for resident cooperative societies. From the assessment year 21-22, it definitely is optional. It is not necessary that you must essentially go for this 22%. It is optional for the cooperative societies. And this 22% will be with applicable surcharge and cess. Let me tell you, this surcharge is right from the beginning. For a regular income tax, the surcharge is applicable if the income exceeds 1 crore rupees. But for 115BAD, that basic exemption of 1 crore rupees or whatever is not available. So with this, we will have to see the repercussions of accepting or otherwise this reduced tax rate of 22% under 115BAD for the cooperative societies. So the my last bullet is cooperative bank versus cooperative societies, but I will take this last bullet after for discussion after we see the next slide. Now next slide is like this, that I am explaining before you the conditions for availing 115BAD. The option has to be exercised for every year before filing the due date for section 139(1). Then option once exercised cannot be withdrawn subsequently. If you go for this option, then the reduced tax rate will be applicable to you, but you will at the same time, you will lose certain deductions, exemptions and incentives. And typically the deduction under section 80P will be lost. That means if you want to claim deduction under section 80P, then you should not go for 115BAD. If you do not want to, or you cannot claim deduction under section 80P, then definitely 115BAD is a beneficial provision. what you lose further is a set of a brought forward loss and unabsorbed depreciation in respect of prescribed deductions, particularly additional depreciation under section 32(1)(AA)(2) and 35(AD) deductions. So such losses you will not be able to carry forward. You will not be able to set off unabsorbed depreciation attributable to the prescribed deduction. Please understand, attributable to the prescribed deduction. If you have regular losses, no problem. Now, suppose you have brought forward depreciation, and this brought forward depreciation pertains to additional depreciation which you have claimed in the plant and machinery. Now, suppose this additional depreciation which is brought forward is not consumed by you, and because you opt for 115 BAD, you will not be able to get the set off of it. So therefore, 115 BAD gives an option. If you choose 115 BAD for the first year of its applicability, that is AY 21-22, then you can correspondingly adjust your block of asset, that is the written down value of assets, by the amount of unabsorbed brought forward depreciation which pertains to the additional depreciation which you have claimed in the earlier year, if that is the case. What is meant by corresponding adjustment is, suppose you have a brought forward unabsorbed depreciation pertaining to additional depreciation which you claimed on the plant and machinery in the earlier years, say for rupees 10 lakh, and today's written down value, say of machinery, is see 20 lakhs, then you can increase this 20 lakh rupees written down value by rupees 10 lakhs, and your written down value for the purpose of calculation of depreciation would be 30 lakh rupees. And on these 30 lakh rupees, you'll be able to claim depreciation 21-22 onwards at the rate of 15%. You will not get the setup of 10 lakh rupees, but your WDV gets automatically enhanced by 10 lakh rupees. 20 lakh becomes 30 lakh rupees as your WDV, and you will be able to claim depreciation on this 30 lakh rupees from 21-22 onwards. But the condition is that you must opt for 115 BAD in the first year, that is 21-22. Suppose you do not opt for 21-22, but you want to go in for it in the subsequent years, then this corresponding adjustment of brought forward depreciation will not be available to you. You will not be able to make claim for additional depreciation. Surcharge, as I told you, will be without any exemptions, and AMT provisions will not be applicable. That is, alternate minimum tax will not be applicable to you, and carry forward or alternate minimum tax, that situation will also not be applicable to you. You will lose any brought forward AMT position with you, that also will be lost. Now, coming back to the earlier side where I had tried to compare the cooperative bank versus cooperative societies. As you all know now, that cooperative banks, they are no more eligible for deduction under section 80P, but other cooperative societies, some are the other way, they are eligible for deduction under section 80P. Cooperative credit societies, Patsamsa, they are eligible for 80P2A1. Similarly, interest from cooperative societies eligible for 80P2D, and so many other provisions, other types of cooperative societies. Now you must take a call, like for say example, cooperative bank. Now there is cooperative bank. What are you going to lose? First, we are going to lose is the brought forward depreciation with respect to additional depreciation. In case of cooperative bank, there is no plant and machinery. There is no question of any additional depreciation. There are no specific exemptions, deductions, or incentives that a cooperative bank is going to lose if they opt for 115 BAD. If that is the case, then it is an instant call for cooperative banks that they must immediately opt for 115 BAD. For cooperative banks, it is the most beneficial provision. 115 BAD is the most beneficial provision for cooperative banks. They must immediately switch over. That means they are going to file their first return under the scheme for AY 21-22 in the next year. So while filing this, they must clearly remember that they will opt for this 115 BAD. But in respect of other cooperative societies, for example, now cooperative credit society Pata Samstha, ATP deduction is available. There is no question of going in for 115 BAD, but there may be some other cooperative societies where it would be difficult to claim ATP deductions because you are not fitting in any of the clauses of section 80P. In that case, you should think of this and you should think in the lines of cooperative bank, and you may go for 115 BAD in such situations. I hope this is clear. Now let's move further. Now I'm going to take urban cooperative banks issues first taxation. Very simple that they have lost ATP from AY 2007-8 and therefore they are now at par with all nationalized banks so far as the income tax is concerned. We just saw 115 BAD. Now this gave them reduced the tax rate of 22%. This is a very most welcome reduction for the cooperative banks. Now, with respect to cooperative banks, there are specific deductions which are available in the Income Tax Act. And these are deductions for bad and doubtful days under Section 3615A. Next is special reserve under Section 3618. Then 43D, interest with respect to NPA. Then investments of the cooperative bank, the various bucket categories and the deductions available therefrom. And the residual categories, other deductions. So I'm going to deal with them one by one. Let us start first with 36178 gives deduction for provision made for BDDR, but the cap is 8.5% of your total income. Total income is the income computed before allowing any deduction under this section and chapter 6A. So this is what you have to calculate the total income, 8.5%, 8.50% plus 10% of the aggregate average rural advances. Now, rural advances, advances given by a rural branch. Rural branch is a branch which is situated in in a place where the population is than 10,000, and this average is to be calculated on the basis of monthly outstanding average advances of the respective branch, and cumulatively can be calculated for the bank. So 8.5% of the total income plus 10% of the aggregate average rural advances. This is the proposition under Section 36178. Now let us take the issues involved and the litigations ongoing with respect to Section 36178. The first issue is, the first thing is, we should all notice the bank is required to make provision in profit and loss account for claiming the deduction under this section. Now, making the provision in the profit and loss account itself is a big issue which we have been dealing with since ATP has been removed. For ATP umbrella has been removed for the cooperative banks, and the dispute is on in respect of very many banks. In some cases, we have reached even high court. Right. The first issue is the deduction to be restricted to the extent of provision made in the profit and loss account? Suppose my BDDR provision in the profit and loss account as per RBI's IRAC norms is required to be made at 10 lakh rupees, but if I calculate 8.5% of my total income and 10% of aggregate average or advances of rural advances comes to say 1 crore rupees. So if I made a provision of 10 lakh rupees in the profit and loss account, but as per this calculation given in 36.17a, if my entitlement is say 4 rupees 1 crore, can I claim the deduction of 1 crore rupees in the computation directly? In spite of the fact that my debit to the profit and loss account for BDDR is just rupees 10 lakh. It's a very live issue. Now let us try to understand why and how can this claim at all be made. Section 36.17a starts with the wording which gives scope for this kind of interpretation. It starts with saying in respect of any provision for bad and doubtful debts made by so many banks and different types of percentage. So the main problem starts with the wording in respect of any provision for bad and doubtful debts. So if I make a provision of 10 lakh rupees, any provision, I fulfill the condition of making any provision, then I should be granted deduction as per 8.5% and 10% of the aggregate average rural advances. That has been the contentions of many banks. And therefore, debit to profit and loss account 1 lakh or 10 lakh rupees in our example, and entitlement as per this 8.5% and 10% at 1 crore rupees. Some banks, some cases, we have been claiming this 1 crore rupees as deduction in the computation in spite of our debit to profit and loss account to 10 lakh rupees. Now, this litigation is going on. Why the view? How the view has been taken by the bank? I just explained you. But what is the present legal position? I tell you, basically there had been two decisions based on which the discussion started or the dispute started. First was, there was a decision of Punjab and Haryana High Court in the case of State Bank of Patiala, where State Bank of Patiala case, Punjab and High Court specifically said that your deduction under Section 36.17a cannot exceed the amount debited to property loss account. That is, in our case, rupees 10 lakh. You cannot claim 1 crore rupees. But, and this, there was simultaneous decision of, in case of Syndicate Bank of the Bangalore branch of IDAT, where it said that it is not necessary that the provision has to be of 1 crore rupees to claim the deduction of 1 crore rupees. You make any provision and therefore you will be eligible for deduction under section 3617 of 1 crore rupees. There are a lot many arguments which can be made in this favor. I mean, if you draw parallel with respect to the wording which is there in this section, and suppose let us take the section of 80D, yes, 80D medical expenditure. Now, if you see the the wording in 80D, particularly 80DDA, I want to say, where you make any expenditure on the mentally retarded person or a physically handicapped person who is totally dependent on you, then it says that you spend any amount and you will be entitled for the N block 40,000 rupees or 50,000 rupees. Now, there is a severity circular with respect to this particular section 80DDA, which says that the deduction of 40,000 or 50,000 rupees, now it is 75,000 and 1 lakh rupees, this will be allowed to the assessee irrespective of the amount of expenditure that has been actually incurred by him. So this is the CBDT circular, or this is the interpretation of CBDT in respect of a particular section, where the wording, phraseology used in the section is similar to what is there in section 3617. This has been one of the arguments. Based on this, this litigation is going on. But as of now, so far as the Pune jurisdiction is concerned, Pune ITAT has been following the only high court judgment which is available right now, following the decision of the Supreme Court in the Vanaspati products, that a high court judgment is available, then you have to follow that if jurisdictional high court judgment is not available. Now, non-jurisdictional high court judgment is State Bank of Patiala, and therefore Pune ITAT, right from Mahalakshmi Cooperative Bank's case, consistently following that the deduction will be available to the extent actual debit to the profit and loss account. In our case, it is 10 lakh rupees. So it is restricted in 10 lakh rupees. But there have been development on this. Recently in 2017, in case of Prathama Bank, Delhi ITAT. Delhi ITAT has given a decision that there is no necessity that the deduction has to be restricted to 10 lakh rupees, as in our case. If you have made the provision of 10 lakh rupees, then you will be entitled for the deduction of 1 crore rupees in the computation as per the formula or the percentages given in the section 3617. So the litigation is going on. There is no direct decision as of now of the Bombay High Court. The only High Court judgment is State Bank of Patiala. In my own case, I am before the Bombay High Court with the same things in two of my clients' cases. We are waiting for the decision from the Bombay High Court. Let us see how the law develops, and then only we'll be able to take the final call. So far as takeaway from this slide, if I am to tell you something, then if the bank wants to be aggressive in its tax planning, you can definitely go for this type of claiming higher deduction. If the bank or its management is of conservative mindset, then you might as well restrict yourself and claim the deduction to the extent the provision is made in the profit and loss account. It will be the call of the client. Okay. Next issue. Now, we have seen 8.5% of the total income and 10% of the aggregate average of the rural advances. Now, the question which was before the tribunal was, is the deduction allowable only for provision in respect of rural advances? Now, in the case of Bhagini Nivedita Cooperative Bank's case, Pune ITAT specifically told that, no, that is not the interpretation of 3617A. The deduction is available for both rural as well as urban advances, though that issue stands settled. Next issue is, can the provision for BDDR be made to profit and loss appropriation account? Now, if there is a problem with respect to the giving a dividend and that kind of trained the bank wants to continue to give the dividend in spite of the lower profitabilities, but at the same time, technically bank wants to meet the requirement of debit of BDDR to the profit and loss account. So is it possible? Okay, whatever, as per IRAC, you have made the provision in the profit and loss account above the line, but below the line, you want to make additional provision just to claim the benefit of 3617A, and so you make further provision in profit and loss appropriation account. Can it be said that you have technically met the requirement of 3617A and you are entitled for the deduction of 3617A, even if the debit is not above the line, but it is below the line, that is in the profit and loss appropriation account? We have a direct decision of Pune 18 in the case of Ganesh Bank of Kurundwad, very old case. And in that case, the ITAT has held the issue in favor of the bank and said that, yes, even if you are debited by way of debit to profit and loss appropriation account below the line, still you will be entitled to make the claim. There is no problem. Next issue with respect to 3617A is, can the requirement of section be technically met by crediting excess BDR to profit and loss account and simultaneously debiting the current year's provision to the profit and loss account? Yes, debit to the profit and loss account of the entire amount and credit to the profit and loss account of the excess BDDR, which was calculated as per IRAC norm last year. Suppose in our case, net requirement is 10 lakh rupees. But if you calculate this year's provision is say 1 crore rupees and excess provision for last year is 90 lakh rupees. So I credit 90 lakh to the profit and loss account and 1 crore to the debit to the profit and loss account. So technically, what I'm making is 1 crore debit to the profit and loss account and 90 lakh rupees credit to the profit and loss account. Now the question is, will I be able to claim the entire 1 crore rupees as a deduction? The answer is simply yes, there is no issue. But what about the taxability of the 90 lakh rupees which has been credited to the profit and loss account, which is an excess BDDR calculated as at the opening of the year? Now, let me discuss this with you. A small discussion and an aggressive way of thinking in terms of taxation. Look, if I have 90 lakh rupees in an excess provision which I made in the profit and loss account, which I reverted and credited to the profit and loss account, the question is, can this 90 lakhs be taxed in my hand, which I reversed and credited to the profit and loss account? Under which section it can be taxed? Now, typically we go to section 41(1) of the Income Tax Act, where any benefit you have claimed in the earlier years and that benefit got reversed, then it is taxable. Now, let us go to the specific wording of section 41(1). Section 41(1) says that any loss, expenditure, or a trading liability, deduction of which you have claimed in earlier years, and that you got back, that you got reimbursed, and that loss is recouped, then it will be taxable under section 41(1). I repeat, loss, expenditure, and trading liability. Now, my poser is the reversal of excess BDDR, which is 90 lakh rupees in our case, to the profit and loss account. Was it a loss which I claimed earlier? Was it an expenditure which I claimed earlier? Or was it a trading liability which deduction I claimed earlier? It definitely was not a loss. It definitely was not a trading liability, but was it an expenditure? Now, expenditure involves, according to my own interpretation, some type of outgo, cash outgo. Then we can call it an expenditure if you go by the general meaning. According to me, BDDR provision, which I claimed earlier by debit and the deduction of which I claimed, is neither loss, nor expenditure, nor trading liability if we interpret it strictly. Now, the second supporting argument in this case is, wherever the legislature wanted that this benefit which the person has claimed, now he has to, when he has got it back, it has to be taxed, then legislature, income tax, had specific provisions. For example, Section 41(4) is with respect to 3617 deduction about bad debts. You claimed bad debts earlier, you recovered the bad debts. Now 3617 is the bad debts deduction. Now you recovered the bad debts, then it is taxable under section 41(4) specific provision. Then there is a special reserve about which we are going to see, 3618. Now 3618 is a special reserve. You have to make a provision and you have to follow certain conditions. If there is a breach of any condition, then there is a specific section, section 41(4A. Section 41(4A specifically says that, yes, if there is any breach of any condition, then whatever deduction you claim for specific reserve, special reserve, then that will not be, that will be taxable under section 41(4A. So there is a specific provision 41(4), specific provision 41(4A for bad debts and special reserve respectively, but there is no corresponding specific provision either under section 41 or under any other section. So the argument stands that such reversal of 90 lakh rupees in our example, will not be liable to tax. I accept that this is a very aggressive argument, but still I feel there is a chance to argue. Particularly, I tell you, in two or three of my cases, what happened is there was such reversal of BDDR in my case, in our bank's case. Okay, I argued on these lines, but I also argued on some other lines, but that some other line was accepted, not this line was accepted. I succeeded in appeal, but that some other line was, I contended that, sir, this reversal is out of the BDDR, which I debited prior to 2007-8 when I was enjoying ATP deduction. So when I was enjoying ATP deduction, that time I have not got the deduction of this BDDR provision, even though it was debited to the profit loss account, because it pertains to the years 2007-8 prior. Since I have not got the deduction, the reversal of it will not be taxable. And this argument has got accepted, but particularly the argument which is we are seeing on the screen has not been still tested, but I accept that it is an aggressive argument, but yes, the chance is there. Next issue is deducted equity standard asset, provision for standard asset, 0.25%, 0.40%. That deduction is not definitely not available. Then there is a condition 36(2)(a). If you want to claim the deduction of 36(1)(7)(a) BDDR, and if there is a write-off of bad debt, then 36(1)(7) deduction will be available to you regarding bad debts, particularly in case of banks, to the extent it exceeds the provision made for BDDR. Suppose your BDDR provision is ₹10 lakh and your bad debts written off is 12 lakh rupees, then this 12 lakh rupees you have to first debit to the BDDR. So 12 lakhs minus 10 lakhs, you have got only 2 lakh rupees excess. 36(1)(7) deduction for bad debts will be available to you only to the extent of rupees 2 lakhs. Now there have been a little dispute, but I'll just skip this. On this issue, there was a dispute, but that dispute is now over. Catholic Syrian Bank's case with the Supreme Court, and there has been amendment now. And because of the amendment, that dispute is now no more. And therefore, I will not discuss. If time permits, we'll discuss later on. But right now, there is no need to discuss. It's not that relevant. Put it down. Accounting for provision. Accounting standard nusar apan je 36(1)(7)(a) chi BDDR chi provision karto, whether that is a provision or reserve, we all agree that it is a provision and it is not a reserve, though it is called actually a reserve. Then I have taken a small example. This will be the last thing on 36(1)(7)(a), which explains a small thing with respect to 36(1)(7)(a). Maza surwatiza BDDR provision aithi 76 lakhachi aahe. Ya varshi mi bad debts 14 crore 12 lakhana mi write off keli. मग मी प्रोविजन डिडक्शन किती घेऊ शकतो, तर 14 crore 12 lakh वजा 76 lakh, म्हणजे मी 13 crore 36 lakhची डिडक्शन घेऊ शकतो आणि त्याप्रमाणे मी क्लेम केली. या वर्षामध्ये 76 lakh ही माझी ओपनिंग प्रोविजन आहे बीडीडीआरची, आणि या वर्षामध्ये प्रोविजन केली मी 1 crore 36 lakh किंवा 136 lakhची मी प्रोविजन केली. मी डिडक्शन क्लेम केली 13 crore 36 lakh कशावरून केली, तर 14 crore 12 lakh वजा 76 lakh 13 crore 36 lakh, म्हणजे मी माझ्या बॅड डेट्स प्रोव्हिजन जे मी बॅड डेट जे 14 crore 12 lakh आहेत ते मी बीडीआर ला डेबिट टाकले. बीडीआर ला क्रेडिट आहे 76 lakh, 14 crore 12 lakh मी डेबिट टाकले. 14 crore 12 lakh डेबिट टाकल्यानंतर माझ्या बॅलन्स आला 13 crore 36 lakh. सो 13 crore 36 lakh मी डिडक्शन क्लेम केली, पण ऍट द एंड ऑफ द इयर पुन्हा मी 1 crore 36 lakhची बीडीआर ची प्रोव्हिजन क्रेडिट केली. म्हणजे वर्षाच्या शेवटी बघितलं तर फक्त 1200 जास्त होतात, पण वर्षाच्या मध्ये जर बघितलं तर 13 crore 36 lakh जास्त होतात. सो आय द बँक क्लेम्स द डिडक्शन ऑफ 13 crore 36 lakh रुपी. द एओ सेज दॅट नो यू विल बी अलाउड ओनली 12 crore, बिकॉज 1 crore 36 lakh जी तुम्ही यावर्षी प्रोव्हिजन केली ती पण आम्ही रिड्यूस करणार. नथिंग टू वरी अबाउट दिस. देर इज द सीबीडीटी सर्क्युलर 17 of 2008. दिस इज अन एक्सक्लुसिव्ह सर्क्युलर. एव्हरीबडी कॅन रेफर टू दिस सर्क्युलर फॉर लॉट मेनी थिंग्स विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू कॉपरेटिव्ह बँक्स गॉट एक्सप्लेन देअर इन सर्क्युलर नंबर 17 of 2008. त्याच्यामधला पॅरा रोमन 2 मध्ये जर बघितलं तर त्यांनी क्लिअरली असं लिहिलंय की ओनली ओपनिंग प्रोव्हिजन ऑफ बीडीडीआर इज टू बी कन्सिडर, आणि त्या क्लॅरिटीमुळे द डिडक्शन इज अलाउड ऍट 13 crore 36 lakh. क्लोजिंग प्रोविजन ऑफ बीडीडीआर मायनस करण्याची आवश्यकता नाही. ओके, नाउ हियर वी स्टॉप विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू 36(1)(7)(a). आता आपण 36(1)(8) ला जाऊया. 36(1)(8) इज अ व्हेरी रिसेंट प्रोविजन. याच्यामध्ये 20% प्रॉफिट ऑफ द इलिजिबल बिझनेस आपल्याला डिडक्शन मिळते. स्पेशल रिझर्व आपल्याला क्रिएट करावा लागतो, आणि हा स्पेशल रिझर्व जो आहे तो दरवर्षीच्या प्रॉफिट लॉस अकाउंटला तुम्ही डेबिट टाकावा लागतो. आणि तुम्हाला परत एकदा मी सांगू इच्छितो या ठिकाणी, इफ यू कम्पेअर द प्रोव्हिजन वर्डिंग ऑफ 36(1)(7)(a) आणि 36(1)(8), तर ह्या दोन्ही प्रोव्हिजन मधला डिफरन्स आपल्या लक्षात येईल. या ठिकाणी आपल्याला असं म्हणावंच लागेल की जेवढा आपण स्पेशल रिझर्व क्रिएट केला तेवढीच आपल्याला रिडक्शन मिळेल, बिकॉज द वर्डिंग इज सच कम्पेरेटिव्ह वर्डिंग. इलिजिबल बिझनेस म्हणजे लॉंग टर्म फायनान्स 5 इयर्स अँड अबोव फॉर इंडस्ट्री अँड ॲग्रिकल्चर डेव्हलपमेंट, डेव्हलपमेंट ऑफ इन्फ्रास्ट्रक्चर फॅसिलिटी अँड डेव्हलपमेंट ऑफ हाऊसिंग. स्पेशल रिझर्व ही डिडक्शन आपण इट शुड नॉट एक्सीड ट्वाइस द पेड अप कॅपिटल इन जनरल रिझर्व, टू दॅट एक्सटेंड ओनली यू कॅन क्लेम द रिडक्शन. बिकॉज दिस डिडक्शन इज व्हेरी रिसेंट लेटेस्ट, देर इज नो लॉट मेनी डिस्प्यूट, देर आर नो मोर डिस्प्यूट ऑन दिस, बट देर इज वन डिस्प्यूट दॅट हॅज अराइजन इन दिस केस. कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक असेल किंवा इंडिव्हिज्युअल बँक असेल, तर त्या बँका ज्या इंडिव्हिज्युअल लोकांना क्लायंटना कस्टमर्सना जे घर खरेदी करण्यासाठी घर बांधण्यासाठी जे कर्ज देतात ते सगळं कर्ज असतं ते 5 वर्ष किंवा त्यापेक्षा नक्कीच जास्त कालावधीचं असतं. आणि दॅट लोन इज कन्सिडर्ड बाय मेनी बँक्स ॲज लोन विच इज फ्रॉम द इलिजिबल बिझनेस अँड बिकॉज इट कंटेन्स डेव्हलपमेंट ऑफ हाऊसिंग अँड देअरफोर each bank is claiming that deduction. But I have a warning signal for all of you that there is one decision of Cochin Tribunal, which is in the case of South Indian Bank. Citation you can see on the screen. Here, South Indian, in the Cochin Tribunal has taken a very stricter view. It says that individual loans given by the banks to various customers, it does not fall in the category of development of housing. Now, development of housing finance can be by the institution like NABARD or Housing Development Bank, because they are the people who are exclusively established for development of housing. They are intern lending finance or doing refinance to the various banks. So they are entitled for this deduction, but individual banks are not entitled. This is a very narrow view which the Cochin Tribunal has taken. I personally do not agree with this decision. And according to me, even the cooperative banks, individual banks who are giving loans to individual borrowers for buying a flat or construction of house, that also falls in the category of development of housing, and they should be entitled for that deduction is definitely my personal view. Yes. Section 43D, really nothing too much talk about because things are now settled. 43D madhe purvi cooperative bankancha ullekh navta, tyamule 43D baptit ek motta issue tayar vayacha ki OIR, overdue interest reserve, that used to be taxed by the income tax officer. त्याच्यानंतर देवगिरी नागरीचा औरंगाबाद बेंचचा बॉम्बे हायकोर्टचा डिसिजन आला विच वॉज इन फेवर ऑफ द बँक्स. दॅट डिसिजन वॉज ऑल्सो ऍक्सेप्टेड बाय द डिपार्टमेंट अँड देर आफ्टर देर वॉज अमेंडमेंट इन सेक्शन 43D विथ सायमल्टेनियस अमेंडमेंट इन सेक्शन 43B दॅट इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ युअन कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक्स, युअन कोऑपरेटिव्ह नॉन शेड्युल बँक्स ऑल्सो, दिस इंटरेस्ट ऑन NPA विल बी taxable only on realization basis or real income theory basis. It will not be taxed now for accrual basis. This issue is over. Now, investment with respect to banks, things are very now straightforward and settled. Kai issues which I want to discuss or put forth before you. Pahla issue hai ki, what about the premium on securities? As we all know, we have 3 categories of investments held by the banks, cooperative banks particularly. Available for sale, that is AFS, held for trading, HFT, these are short-term investments, and there is one that is HTM, that is held till maturity. Now, out of these 3 categories, 2 categories are short-term, and therefore depreciation and all those things with respect to this AFS and HFT category, we can definitely claim the deduction as the market value goes down. But with respect to held till maturity, first thing is that there is a premium which is paid at the time of acquisition of these securities. Now this premium is amortized over the remaining life of this security as per the RBI guidelines on this investment accounting, and this premium is also deductible specifically because circular number 17 of 2008 para 7 says that the treatment for the expenditure is to be given as per the RBI directions for accounting of the investment. Now, RBI says that you debit the premium, amortize the premium on acquisition of the long-term securities over the remaining life of the securities. And that being the case, the deduction is to be allowed because the accounting or the claim or debit to the profit and loss account is exactly as per the RBI guidelines. and a case law, Bombay High Court, directly in our favor, HDFC banks, and it has been followed in many other cases. Mostly the issue stands settled. With respect to interest of pre-acquisition period, that means you purchase a security today, and as of now, as on today, suppose certain interest has already accrued. Suppose 30th June is the date of actual payment, X interest and come interest situation I'm talking. So whatever interest which pertains to the pre-acquisition period, that means suppose the interest date is 31st December and 30th June, then if you are purchasing the security today, then from 1st January to 15th of June or 16th of June will be a pre-acquisition period interest. Vijay Bank case Supreme Court against us, and circular 17 of 2008, para 26, it says that it has to be capitalized. Now, there are some other issues which I would just brush upon. Unclaimed dividends will not be taxable, even because they are dividend. Their 41(1) section will not apply to that. Penal interest, even if credited to reserve fund, will be taxable. Building fund, some banks are collecting along with their loan processing. Now, building fund, previously I used to argue the case of building fund on the basis that it is a capital receipt. But with the advent of section 56210 now, which is a money received without any consideration even for a bank, and because 56.27A versus 56.210, 56.27 used to apply only to the individual and HUF, but now 56.210 applies to any person. From that perspective, now the building fund may be taxable. As of now, no authority to this thing is available. But yes, in my opinion, 56.210 can create a problem. Section 14A is a routine case, nothing specific for cooperative banks. Particularly for cooperative banks, now there is no exempt income as such, and therefore there is no question of section 14A, because now onwards even dividend from mutual fund is also going to be taxable. One question to be answered to all of us is whether any reporting in tax audit report is required to be made with respect to cooperative credit societies, cooperative bank, vis-a-vis the applicability of provisions of section 48(2B), that is the payment to relatives. Now, there is no concept of relatives with respect to any cooperative society or a bank. And Bombay High Court, in this case, has specifically said that there is no question of application of Section 48(2B) with respect to cooperative banks or cooperative societies. So, no question of any reporting on that. Not applicable. Excess cash received. Now, banks give different treatments. After a certain period, the excess cash is transferred to reserve fund. When you say that it is transferred to reserve fund, that means you are denying a liability of any other person. And once it is transferred to reserve fund, that means it becomes permanently your income, then it is taxable. If it is shown as continued as a liability, then it is not like not taxable. In the sense, the bank keeps on acknowledging the liability that tomorrow or day after, whenever the person comes with a claim, it might have to be paid. But if it is transferred to reserve fund, it becomes your income. Audit fees provision 43B is not applicable. Loss on merger, when there is an excess of liabilities over the asset, that means it is a goodwill, but it is considered to be an intangible asset in the case of Cosmos Bank by the Pune ITAT, and it has been held to be eligible for depreciation at the rate of 25%, which is applicable to the intangible assets. Okay. Now, this is the discussion on the various sections which we saw. And now I'm taking up the most hot topic of today. Probably all of you must be waiting for this discussion. Section 194A and Section 194N.
Sir,
yes.
Sir, thoda sa motha ne bola chat hai.
Okay, fine. Okay. First, before I take up actually Section 194N or 194A, I'm just taking you to this small change in the Finance Act 2020. There is one section 206A, which requires every bank for that matter, to file a separate return 26QA. We are filing 26Q for interest and other TDS payments on which TDS has been deducted. But there is a separate return which is required to be filed, which is form 26QA, by all the banks who are paying interest income below the threshold of rupees 10,000. And previously it was to be filed on this floppy diskette, etc. But the small change is that it can be filed on a prescribed mode. Probably the mode will be an online mode. As of now, the situation stands as it was. The prescribed mode, still there is no prescription as of now. Okay. With this, now we come to section 194N. Section 194N prescribes for TDS at the rate of 2% on cash withdrawals exceeding rupees 1 crore in a year. Deductors who are liable to do the TDS are banks, cooperative society engaged in carrying on the business of banking. Please note my words, cooperative society engaged in carrying on the business of banking. The wording is not cooperative bank, but this wording, and the post office. Now, the limit is for the bank, one account and or any account maintained by the recipient with it. And this provision of section 194N is not applicable to government banking company. I mean, these are the withdrawers. The government withdraws money from any other bank. Any banking company withdraws money from any other bank, its office account. And a cooperative society engaged in carrying on the business of banking withdraws any amount, any cash from its account with any other bank, nationalized bank. So cooperative society engaged in, say for example, cooperative bank withdrawing cash from its account with a nationalized bank. So cooperative bank as a deductee is not required to be subjected to TDS at the rate of 2% under section 194N. The point which I want to make here is that as a deductor, it is, the section is applicable to cooperative society engaged in carrying on the business of banking as a deductor. And as a deductee, provisions of section 194N are not applicable to the cooperative society engaged in carrying on the business of banking. Please understand, or please let me repeat this, that the wordings used here are not cooperative bank, but the wording used here are cooperative society engaged in carrying on the business of banking. With this, we will let us proceed further. Now, 194N and the Finance Act 2020, there is a major change. Now, this change, which is there in the Finance Act 2020, was not there in Finance Bill 2020. Apan je budget baghitla, kiwa budget varsa je discussion zala, tyachyamadhye ha change kutehi navta. हा चेंज ही जी अमेंडमेंट 194N मध्ये आहे ती ही 194N मधली अमेंडमेंट डायरेक्टली फायनान्स ऍक्ट मध्ये आली. पार्लमेंट मध्ये इंट्रोड्यूस केला गेला, बजेट मध्ये नव्हता, ऍक्ट मध्ये आला आणि डायरेक्ट आली. बट दिस इज व्हेरी सिरियस अमेंडमेंट. सिरियस इन द सेन्स इट इन्क्रीजेस द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑफ टीडीएस विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू द बँक अँड इट इन्क्रीज द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी फॉर अस एज चार्टर्ड अकाउंटंट्स हू आर डूइंग द टॅक्स ऑडिट और हू आर कन्सल्टंट टू व्हेरियस कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक्स. The amendment is that the threshold limit has been reduced to 20 lakh rupees for a non-filer of the income tax return. And the slab is 2% if the withdrawal in an account from an account is 20 lakh rupees to 1 crore rupees. And if it exceeds 4 crore rupees, then the limit, the TDS amount is, TDS percentage is going to be 5%. So 2% up to 1 crore rupees, threshold is 20 lakh rupees. And if you exceed 1 crore rupees, the TDS is to be 5% if you are a non-filer. Please understand what do you mean by non-filer with the words which are highlighted in the red. The non-filer has to be a person who has not filed all of his returns for the last 3 years within the time limit given under section 139(1). Manje, मागच्या तीनही वर्षात त्याचं रिटर्न 139(1) च्या ड्यू डेट पूर्वी भरलं गेलं नसलं असलं पाहिजे. म्हणजे द ब्रिच ऑर द डिफॉल्ट हॅज टू बी इन ऑल द थ्री प्रिव्हियस इयर्स. मीन्स इफ यू आर डिस्कसिंग ऑफ टुडेज टीडीएस, देन यू हॅव टू थिंक ऑफ द थ्री इयर्स विच हॅव एंडेड ऑन 31st March 2020. That is 1920, 1899, 1718. For all the three previous years, his return ought to be delayed or he should not at all been filed. The default has to be all the 3 years and not in any of these 3 years. This is my interpretation. So let us understand this. And now with this, we proceed further. The main poser which I am raising here is that the exemption is available in the section 194N. As a deductor, you are liable to deduct if you are a cooperative society engaged in the business of banking. And as a deductee, you are exempt from the TDS provisions of 194N if you are a society engaged in carrying on the business of banking. So the direct on the point, can Pat Samsthas be considered to be engaged in carrying on the business of banking? Now, this is a very big issue, and this issue has correlation with the amendments in section 194A. So we are going to now answer or try to find out the answer to this question. Can persons be considered to be carrying on the business of banking? Let us first address the amendments in section 194A, and then we will try to answer this question. So let us take this first, section 194A. What are the changes and what is the situation prevailing before the changes were made? Look here, section 194A subsection 3 gives various exemptions from TDS. For example, it says that for a senior citizen, 50,000 rupees, for others it is 40,000 rupees, and if you are not a bank, then it is if you are a set trader or HF or a partnership firm, then the limit is 5,000 rupees. So these are given in section 194A3. Now, in 194A3, Roman 3, the exemption is interest paid to any banking company or any cooperative society engaged in carrying on the business of banking. So whatever interest is paid, whoever is the payer, whoever, it may be government, it may be a government company, it may be an individual, it may be a firm, company, HF, whatever, whoever is the payer, irrespective of the payer, whatever interest is paid by that payer to any banking company, jasa apan ekhadya bankela bankecha karzavarcha vyaj deto tyala apan TDS karat nahi apan tyacha. Same thing is here, that interest paid to any banking company or interest paid to any cooperative society engaged in carrying on the business of banking, 198.3, there it is not liable to TDS. Right, let us move next. Now 194A3 is Roman small 5. It gives, or rather it gave exemption till 31st March 2020 for interest paid by a cooperative society to its member, interest paid by a cooperative society other than a cooperative bank. So cooperative bank giving interest to members, liable to TDS, we all know. But cooperative society other than cooperative bank giving interest to any of its member, it was not liable to TDS because of 194A35. And next is interest paid by a cooperative society to any other cooperative society. Any cooperative society, payer is a cooperative society, pay is also cooperative society. Now here, payer cooperative society would include even cooperative bank. Cooperative bank is not excluded from this. Cooperative bank is excluded from only interest payable to members. Cooperative bank is made liable to pay to make the TDS from interest paid to members, but it was not liable prior to 31st March 2020 for interest paid by it to any other cooperative society, because it fault in it fell in this category, interest paid by a cooperative society to any other cooperative society. Now 194A35 has been amended. Now this amendment is this. Amendment Finance Act 2020 has withdrawn the exemption given under 194A35 only is to be there. This exemption is withdrawn only in respect of cooperative society whose gross receipts in the preceding year exceed 50 crore rupees. Let me tell you, this gross receipt exceeding rupees 50 crore rupees, that means not the turnover as calculated in the balance sheet, but gross receipts, sales or turnover here means the credit side, total of the credit side of the profit and loss account, excluding if loss is there. Total of all incomes credited to the profit and loss account is to be calculated, is to be seen, and not the turnover in the deposits or turnover in the loans. That is not the concept here. Here the concept is sales, gross receipts or income of the cooperative society, and that means it is the credit side's total of all incomes. If it exceeds 50 crore rupees in the previous year, then this exemption which is given under section 194A35, that has been withdrawn, and that has been withdrawn from 1st April 2020, and they have been made liable to the TDS even if the interest is paid to a member or interest is paid to any other cooperative society, right? So with this now, we come to the implications of it. Now, what are the implications? With respect to cooperative banks with gross receipts or turnover above rupees 50 crore rupees, now they have two sections to see, 194 3A exemption for TDS on interest paid to any cooperative society, this exemption still there. There is, it has not been touched. But in 194A35, this exemption has been withdrawn. And because this has been withdrawn, the problem is with respect to the cooperative banks is that any interest by such big cooperative banks paid to the cooperative, any other cooperative society, will now be liable to TDS. Now, in respect of cooperative society, Pata Samstha, whether Pata Samstha's interest or interest paid by a cooperative society, interest paid by a cooperative bank is an interest paid to any cooperative society engaged in carrying on the business of banking, that is this clause, or it falls in the other category, that it is simply an interest paid by a cooperative society to any other cooperative society. I hope you are understanding the difference. Suppose a cooperative bank with more than 50 crores of receipts or income having deposits from a cooperative sugar factory and a cooperative pat samstha. Now, cooperative sugar factory is any other cooperative society. 194A35, which was available till 31st March 2020, is not there. And in respect of a cooperative sugar factory, tyancha jagay thevi cooperative sugar factory cha jagay thevi atta cooperative bank ikade asha mothya bank ikade astil tyana tya sagalya thevi varcha vyajala ata without any dispute TDS ha karava lagel asha bankana jancha gross receipts are more than 50 crore. The question remains about the interest on deposits of cooperative pata samstha, cooperative credit society. Because as I told you, otherwise I have taken you to the point, whether cooperative pata samstha can be considered to be engaged in carrying on the business of banking so that they can enjoy the exemptions of section 194A33, because the exemption still contains what has been withdrawn is 194A35. So if cooperative pata samstha can be considered to be carrying on the business of banking, they get the exemption under section 194A33. And if they are not called to be, or they are not to be taken as carrying on the business of banking, then they will lose the benefit of 194A33, and they will be falling in 194A35, and their deposits or interest on their deposit will also be liable to TDS, just like the deposits of a cooperative sugar factory, as I explained you in my example. Now I am taking you to the discussion of whether cooperative pata samstha can be considered to be engaged in carrying on the business of banking. Let us see the definition of banking. What is the definition of banking? Banking means, as we all know, that acceptance of deposits and lending money to the giving loans to the public, and then withdrawal by money draft, otherwise whatever. The highlighted word is from the public. Highlighted word in the definition is from the public. As we all know that pata samstha, they are not allowed to deal with public. They are only allowed to deal with the members. And if you draw a very restricted meaning, then pata samstha, when they are not allowed to deal with public, then they cannot be considered to be carrying on the business of banking. Now, this particular issue, not with respect to TDS, but with respect to allowability of deduction under section 80B, with respect to cooperative banks, is before the Bombay High Court in many decisions. TDS badal nahi, ATP 4, jo navin section ATP 4 ala, ATP 4 madhe kay jala ki cooperative bankanna ATP 2A1 cha deduction milnar nahi, ATP 2A1. ATP 2A1 is what? ATP 2A1 is the deduction under section ATP for the cooperative societies who are engaged in providing credit facilities to their members or engaged in carrying on the business of banking. Providing credit facilities to the members or providing credit facilities to their members. Now, the department has been taking a stand that pata samsthas who are dealing with nominal members, or while they are dealing with general public, they are making them nominal members and they are dealing with this, they are akin to cooperative banks. And what is the definition of cooperative bank? Where do you take the definition of cooperative bank? Because cooperative bank has not been defined in Income Tax Act. The definition of cooperative bank has to be taken specifically so, because it has been specifically mentioned in the just below the provision to section 84, that the definition is as given in the Banking Regulation Act. And the Banking Regulation Act defines cooperative bank as either स्टेट कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक, सेंट्रल कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक और प्रायमरी कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक. फॉरगेट अबाउट स्टेट अँड सेंट्रल कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक, बट लेट अस थिंक अबाउट द प्रायमरी कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक. द प्रायमरी कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक इज द बँक which has to fulfill three conditions. These three conditions are given in section 5cc1, and these three conditions are: the principal business or the principal object of the cooperative of the society has to be banking, second, share capital has to be more than 1 lakh rupees, and third, the bylaws of the society should not permit admission of any other cooperative society as its member. Apan dusre ani tisre condition kade jayla nako. Pahili condition ashi hai that the principal object or the principal, they should be engaged in principal, their principal activity is to be of the banking. And it has been the argument of the department that they are almost engaged in banking, and that is why provisions of section 80P4 are applicable to them. They are not eligible for deduction under section 80P2A1. Nagpur bench in Buldana Urban, the case was ATP, whether Buldana Urban is eligible for ATP or not. Now here you can read it here that since society is not entitled or not their aims are none of the aims or objects allow the cooperative society to accept deposits from public for the purpose of lending or investment, since it is not allowed to deal with public, it cannot be said to be engaged in the business of banking, and therefore it is not cooperative bank, and therefore ATP 2A1 is eligible. They are entitled to ATP 2A1. They are not barred by ATP 4. Listen this. We are talking of ATP 2A1 versus ATP 4. The case was whether Buldana Urban like Cooperative Credit Society is barred or not entitled for deduction under section ATP 2A1 because of the provisions of ATP 4, which have been brought in the statute book from year 2007-8. And the Bombay High Court Nagpur bench has held that no, Cooperative Society like Buldana Urban, their object do not allow them to deal with public, and that is why they cannot be called to be engaged in the business of banking, and therefore they cannot be called to be primary bank, primary cooperative bank, and therefore they are not cooperative bank, and therefore they are entitled for deduction under section ATP 2A1, not barred by ATP 4. That is the decision. Now similar decision is there in KPM Cooperative Credit Society, where on the basis of it cannot be, they were dealing, but the dealing with the non-members was minuscule, very small. So the Panji bench of the Bombay High Court said that on this basis, it cannot be concluded that the apparent principal business is of accepting deposit from public, and therefore it is in banking business. This is the conclusion of the Bombay High Court in Panji bench and KPM Cooperative Credit Society. Now we have a very interesting situation vis-a-vis the Pune ITAT is concerned. Pune ITAT in Jankalyana Pata Samstha, with the same situation, ATP 2A1 versus ATP 4, it says that no, their object do not permit them to deal with the cooperative general public, and therefore there's no question of calling them as engaged in banking, and therefore they cannot be called to be cooperative bank. They are entitled for deduction under section ATP 2A1. But Maharashtra Aarogya Mandal versus ITO 28 SOT 26, this decision is also of the ITAT Pune, but this decision is with respect to altogether different context. Now Maharashtra Aarogya Mandal had kept, it's a section 12A registered charitable trust, and as an compliance of section 11.5 madhe charitable trust la aplya investment eka vishisht mhanje tharavik section 11.5 madhe namud kelelya institutions madhe guntavya lagtat. Now Maharashtra Aarogya Mandalna apli guntavanuk eka cooperative samsthe madhe keleli hoti, cooperative pata samsthe madhe keleli hoti. ITO ni mhatle ki no, you are not made investment in the prescribed mode, because cooperative credit society ka pata samstha hi ji ahe is not the prescribed mode of investment. It is not a bank. You cannot call it as a society which is engaged in the carrying of the business of banking. It's a bagay. Departments are altogether different argument. Exactly 360 degree opposite argument hai. The department ya tikani mhantay ki ja tikani tumhi guntavanuk keli pata samsthe madhe guntavanuk keli section 11.5 cha compliance madhe, that investment is not an investment in the cooperative society engaged in the business of carrying on banking. Now here the assessee was saying no, that society is the society which is engaged in the business of caring and banking. And ITAT Pune has accepted the argument of the appellant. It has held that the investment in the Patasamsa is an investment
in a society carrying on the business of banking and therefore is an eligible investment, section 115 eligible investment, you cannot deny section 11 exemption to such society. Now these are in different contexts, but the issue remains common. One is saying Pata Samstha, they are not engaged in the business of banking while allowing ATP 2A1. And the other decision is saying they are engaged in the carrying on the business of banking while considering the investment made in them for the purpose of prescribed modes given under section 11.5. Now, with this dilemma, we move further. We just try to see what is further. Now, Kerala High Court, in this 112.1.272, Chirayim Kuju, Service Cooperative Society versus CBDT. In this case, the issue was directly on the point. आता या संस्थेने ही एक कोऑपरेटिव्ह सोसायटी आहे. या संस्थेने काय केलं होतं, या संस्थेने गव्हर्नमेंट ट्रेझरी मध्ये इन्व्हेस्टमेंट केलेली होती. आता गव्हर्नमेंट ट्रेझरी इज नॉट अ कोऑपरेटिव्ह सोसायटी, सो त्यांना जे इंटरेस्ट मिळत होतं ते एका गव्हर्नमेंट डिपार्टमेंटकडनं मिळत होतं. तर या पतसंस्थेनं असं आर्ग्युमेंट केलं की वी आर अ सोसायटी इन एंगेज इन कॅरिंग ऑन द बिझनेस ऑफ बँकिंग, त्यामुळं आम्हाला 194A33A ची exemption amala available hai, and therefore we fall in that first category. The exemption of is still continuing. We are a cooperative society engaged in the business of carrying banking, and there should no TDS should be made. The High Court has held against the society. The High Court says that no, you cannot be called to be a society carrying on the business of banking because you are not allowed to accept deposits from public. You are allowed to do the business only with your members. And doing business only with the members is not doing with the business with the public, and therefore you will not be exempt from TDS under section 194A33A, and therefore you will be liable. Okay, now with this background, now let us come what is lying before us. What is lying before us is that the matter is before the Supreme Court. There is no direct decision as of now from the Supreme Court. Particularly, I have referred KPM Cooperative Credit Society. Now, KPM Cooperative Credit Society, SLP, has been admitted by the Supreme Court in this case of the department. Department has gone to the Supreme Court. And many other cases, particularly from Kerala High Court, there are a lot of cases which have reached now Supreme Court. And in a number of cases, SLP also has been admitted. Now, what is going to happen is, a department is going to say, these are the societies which are engaged in carrying on the business of banking because they are dealing with members, non-members, nominal members, almost like general public. And B, if they are engaged in the carrying on the business of banking, they fulfill the definition of primary cooperative bank. And because they fulfill the definition of primary cooperative bank, they are cooperative bank, not entitled for ATP 4. As a department's argument, याच्या बरोबर अगेन्स्ट या सगळ्या अपेलंट कोऑपरेटिव्ह सोसायटीचा आर्ग्युमेंट राहणार आहे. आम्ही पब्लिक बरोबर डीलच करत नाही. आमच्या ऑब्जेक्ट बघा तुम्ही, आमच्या ऑब्जेक्ट मध्ये असं लिहिलेलं आहे की वी कॅन डील ओनली विथ द मेंबर्स, ऍट द मोस्ट विथ द नॉमिनल मेंबर्स, अँड त्यामुळं वी कॅनॉट बी कॉल्ड टू बी डीलिंग विथ जनरल पब्लिक. अँड बिकॉज वी कॅनॉट डील विथ जनरल पब्लिक, वी कॅनॉट बी कॉल्ड टू बी एंगेज इन द बिझनेस ऑफ बँकिंग. आता देर विल बी मेनी अदर आर्ग्युमेंट, बट दिस विल बी ऑल्सो वन ऑफ द आर्ग्युमेंट. आणि या आर्ग्युमेंट नंतर जर सुप्रीम कोर्ट बाय एनी चान्स इफ गिव्ह इट्स वर्डिक्ट ऑन दिस लाईन, होल्डिंग आयदर वे दॅट इज कोऑपरेटिव्ह सोसायटीज आर एंगेज इन द बिझनेस ऑफ बँकिंग, और कोऑपरेटिव्ह कॅनॉट बी सेट टू बी एंगेज इन द कॅरिंग ऑन द बिझनेस ऑफ द बँकिंग, देन the situation is going to be altogether different. The point which I want to make here is everything depends upon the interpretation which we give to this particular aspect as to whether a cooperative society can be called to be carrying on or engaged in the business of banking. And leaving this a gray area, we now discuss the further implications which are there now in front of us. Cooperative bank with gross receipts or turnover up to or less than 50 crore rupees. More than 50 crore rupees, we saw that TDS by them to the members is liable to be taxed, liable to TDS. But and TDS by them to the cooperative credit society also liable to TDS. But if the cooperative bank is a smaller bank, then TDS on members deposit continues, but they are not liable to TDS on the interest paid by them to other cooperative societies because The exemption is still available under 194A35. 194A35 is drawn only for the bigger cooperative societies or banks. Similarly, now let us talk with respect to cooperative societies. As a director, if a cooperative society is there whose gross receipts are more than 50 crore rupees, say cooperative bank, a cooperative sugar factory or a cooperative spinning mill, where their turnover is more than 50 crore rupees, then they are now at par with cooperative banks, bigger cooperative banks. They have to do the TDS on interest paid to the members. They have to do the TDS by them on interest paid to any other cooperative societies. But if you are a cooperative society with your gross less than 50 crore rupees, then the life is the same as before for you. You neither have to do the TDS on interest paid to members, nor have you to do the TDS to interest paid by you to other cooperative societies. Now, with this, I just give you this table. Now, this table explains everything. Whatever I discussed is tabulated in this table. Cooperative banks, if you are bigger cooperative bank, then TDS is liable in respect of both, that is interest paid to members, interest paid to members, as well as interest paid to cooperative societies. If you're a smaller bank, then only liable for interest on members, you're not liable to TDS on interest paid to cooperative society. If you have a cooperative society, turnover more than gross receipts more than 50 crore rupees, liable to TDS for both. And if you're a small cooperative society, then you are not liable to TDS on either of the things, TDS paid to interest on members or TDS paid to TDS on interest to cooperative societies. I hope this issue gets clear. Now, if anything on that, then we can discuss further. Next issue in line with this is, can Pat Samstha give Form 15G or 15G to the director cooperative bank to get the exemption from TDS? The answer is clearly no. Because section 197A1B is very clear on this. Yachyamadhye section madhye wording is jar apan vachla tar aplyala lakshat yeil ki the provisions of this section 197A 15G apan jo deto to section 197A khali deto, pan ha section apply konala hot nahi. Where the amount of any income referred to in this section as a case may be exceeds or is likely to exceed the maximum amount which is not chargeable to income tax. Now, maximum amount not chargeable to income tax act, that is a basic exemption. Basic exemption concept applies only to HUF, individual and HUF, 250,000 rupees. For a cooperative society, there is no question of any basic exemption. Now, this basic exemption, our first slab starts from 0 to 10,000 rupees, we saw in the very first slide. So there is no question of basic exemption, and because there is no basic exemption, even a 10 rupee interest will otherwise fall because it exceeds the maximum amount which is not chargeable to income tax, and therefore 15G cannot be given. And the last issue on this is TDS in respect of nominal members. Now, TDS in respect of nominal members, let me tell you members that this, the legal position with respect to nominal members has not changed. Means मॉडेल बॉयलर्स किंवा आदर्श आपले जे उपविधी आहेत त्याच्यामध्ये महाराष्ट्र सरकारने आता हे आणलेलं आहे. अँड आय ॲज आय अंडरस्टँड इट द टाइम लिमिट हॅज बीन एक्सटेंडेड 31 मार्च 2021. म्हणजे तोपर्यंत तरी आपल्याला प्रॉब्लेम नाही आहे. तोपर्यंत तरी वी हॅव अ व्हेरी स्पेसिफिक डिसिजन ऑफ द बॉम्बे हायकोर्ट इन द केस ऑफ जळगाव डिस्ट्रिक्ट कॉपरेटिव्ह बँक, वेअर बॉम्बे हायकोर्ट इज ऑन रेकॉर्ड स्पेसिफिकली सेईंग दॅट if a definition of member is not there in the income tax act, we have to go and see the definition of member in the cooperative societies act. And in the cooperative societies act, it has been specifically stated that member include all types of member, sympathizer member, associate member, nominal members, everything. So that decision of Jalgaon district cooperative bank was with respect to TDS on interest paid to nominal members. The CBDT has issued a circular. Jalgaon district cooperative bank had challenged that circular before the Bombay High Court, and the Bombay High Court held in favor of the bank. It ruled out the circular of the CBDT. It said that the circular of the CBDT is ultra vires, and interest paid to nominal members is not, म्हणजे at that time HR 2007 नंतर situation वेगळे. At that time it said that interest paid to nominal members by the cooperative banks at that time was not liable to TDS. So, but the ratio of this decision still applies for nominal members, and we continue to enjoy this exemption. This I can skip. And now I will take directly the cooperative credit societies. Cooperative patasanshanchya baptit pahila issue ahe to nationalize and cooperative bankanni bankancha je vyaj milta cooperative bank cooperative patasanshana tyachya baptit totkar cha decision supreme court cha decision baryach thikani vaparla jato but that decision is no longer relevant with respect to cooperative patasanshya because totkar is a vikas society mhanje purchase and sale society hoti tyancha surplus funds tyanni nationalize and cooperative bank madhe thevlele hote pan patasanshya baptit asa surplus fund cha vishay asu shakat nahi. Normally they invest only the circulating capital, and this concept has been accepted by the Pune IIT in the NIFARD cooperative NIFARD Pata Samstha. This decision continues to be followed in many other decisions. So far as this aspect is concerned, we can rest assured that the things will be at least held in our favor at the Pune IIT. Citizens cooperative credit societies are issue discuss kele shivay lecture acha purna hou shakat nahi. The problem is citizens cooperative credit society that decision has to be discussed because recently many of the cases additions have been made in assessment under section 143 in AY 2017-18 jacha assessment atta December 2019 madhe samplele ahet and tyachyamadhe mothe additions zalele ahet and tya saglya additions ja zalele ahet tya citizens cooperative credit society cha basis var zalele ahet. First let us understand what is citizens cooperative society. Small agdi short madhe sangen mi citizens cooperative credit society was a society registered in Andhra Pradesh under and their act is mutually aided cooperative societies act. Ya ja society hi ji society hoti it was mostly dealing with the nominal members or non members ani most of the deposits ja tyancha ja hote tya nominal members kadna hotya ani tya sagle ja deposit ja hotya tya लोन देण्यासाठी वापरले होते गोल्ड लोन्स वगैरे असेल अँड एज अ मॅटर ऑफ फॅक्ट इट वॉज फाउंड दॅट द सोसायटी वॉज मोस्टली वुड बी कॉल्ड एज एंगेज इन बिझनेस ऑफ फायनान्स रादर दॅन प्रोव्हाइडिंग क्रेडिट फॅसिलिटीज टू इट्स मेंबर्स दॅट वॉज द ऑब्झर्वेशन ऑफ द आयटीओ देन वॉट एव्हर ऍक्टिव्हिटीज ऑफ द सोसायटीज वेर देअर सोसायटी वॉज देअर दे वेर हेल्ड टू बी इलिगल इन द सेन्स दॅट दे वर नॉट विथ द अप्रूव्हल ऑफ द रजिस्टर ऑफ सोसायटीज अँड quite a few of the provisions in giving the loans or accepting the deposits were in violations I mean the activities were in violation of the mutual aided cooperative societies act the act which prevails in Andhra Pradesh and concept of mutuality was altogether missing in this case and that is how the Supreme Court went on holding that the society is not entitled for deduction under section 80B 2A1. आता हा जर डिसिजन तुम्ही वाचला तर हा डिसिजन अगदी स्पेसिफिक आहे हा डिसिजन एटीपी 4 वरचा डिसिजन पण आहे वेदर एटीपी 4 इज ऍप्लिकेबल टू कॉपरेटिव्ह क्रेडिट सोसायटीज सुप्रीम कोर्ट इज क्लिअरली सेईंग दॅट एटीपी 4 विच बॅन्स एटीपी डिडक्शन फॉर कॉपरेटिव्ह बँक दॅट एटीपी 4 इज नॉट ऍप्लिकेबल टू कॉपरेटिव्ह सोसायटी लाईक सिटीजन्स कॉपरेटिव्ह सोसायटी आय मीन द डिपार्टमेंटनं दोन्ही बाजूंनी आर्ग्यू केलं होतं एक म्हणजे ह्याचा हा सगळा बिझनेस आहे तो व्हायोलेशन आहे फायनान्स बिझनेस आहे नॉट अ कॉपरेटिव्ह बिझनेस अँड सेकंड डिपार्टमेंटचं आर्ग्युमेंट होतं की एटीपी 4 मध्ये ह्या बसतात द बार ऑफ एटीपी 4 इज ऍप्लिकेबल हे जे सेकंड आर्ग्युमेंट होतं सुप्रीम कोर्टने ते त्यांचं मान्य केलं नाही डिपार्टमेंटचं पण पहिलं जे आर्ग्युमेंट होतं ज्याच्यामध्ये या सगळ्या व्हायोलेशन होत्या म्युच्युअलिटीचं कन्सेप्ट नव्हती आणि ट्रान्झॅक्शन विदाउट द अप्रूव्हल ऑफ द रजिस्टर ऑफ कॉपरेटिव्ह सोसायटीज अँड वॉट एव्हर द ऍक्टिव्हिटीज वेअर बियॉन्ड द बायलॉज ऑफ द सोसायटी विथ ऑल दिस the supreme court accepted the verdict given by cit appeals itat andhra pradesh high court and it held in favor of the department and atp was denied but when it came to application of citizen cooperative decision in our area in maharashtra then a lot of argument a lot of discussion took place and a distinction was tried to be made with respect to the decision which is there or the criteria which are laid down in citizens cooperative credit society by the supreme court and the situation which prevails in maharashtra and it has been now clearly accepted that Sai Prerna Gramin Patasanshad decision is available and Pune IIT has accepted the arguments put forth on behalf of the Patasanshad that the decision of citizens cooperative credit society is not applicable in situations like Maharashtra because Maharashtra is governed by Maharashtra State Cooperative Societies Act where it allows to deal with nominal members and these arguments in case of Sai Prerna, Gramin Patra Samstha, and many other, there were about 10 cooperative societies and all the APIs were heard together. And the authorized representative or the argument on behalf of the cooperative Patra Samsthas were on two counts. The first count is distinction between the law as which prevails in cooperative mutually aided cooperative societies in Andhra Pradesh and what is the law in Maharashtra. So, and those situations are not applicable. And the second argument was, even if the societies in cooperative societies, Patra Samsthas in Maharashtra deal with nominal members, this dealing with nominal members is not in any violation of either the bylaws or violation of the Maharashtra State Cooperative Societies Act. It is within the bylaws, within the four corners of the bylaws and the Maharashtra State Cooperative Society Act. There is no violation. There is no question of any permission to be obtained from the register of cooperatives because there is no question of any violation. There is nothing beyond bylaws. And this argument was made on the basis of the decision of the Bombay High Court in Jalgaon District Cooperative Bank, which we discussed. So both these arguments were accepted by the Pune ITAT, and it has been held in favor of Patra Samstha that Citizens Cooperative Credit Society as such will not apply in our cases where the dealing is only with the members and nominal members. But if there is a decision, if there is a dealing with directly with non-members, then ATP deduction to the extent the dealings are with non-members, then the deduction will not be allowed. So that is how section ATP now remains. There are small things which I will not take, but I will take only the last 5 minutes on this, which is I think very relevant for all of us to discuss. आता आपल्याला बऱ्याच जणांना सीपीसी कडून नोटिसेस आलेल्या आहेत किंवा काही ठिकाणी अशा मोठा प्रॉब्लेम होऊन बसलेला आहे की ज्या आपल्याला माहिती आहे सगळ्यांना की एटीपी डिडक्शन असेसमेंट इयर 2018-19 पासून कधी अवेलेबल आहे, ओनली इफ यू फाईल युअर रिटर्न बिफोर द ड्यू डेट फॉर फायलिंग द रिटर्न. नाऊ काही लोकांना हे पहिल्या वर्षी कळालं नाही, शक्य झालं नाही, काही लोकांना खरोखर अडचणी होत्या आणि त्यामुळे ते रिटर्न फाईल झाले नाहीत आणि दे हॅव नॉट रिसिव्ह इंटिमेशन फ्रॉम सीपीसी denying the deduction of ATP and they have been taxed with the entire income, raising a huge demand. And this has been a problem with quite a few of us. And that is why I thought this issue we will discuss. And is there any chance for us to fight the case for the cooperative credit societies, cooperative Patra Samstha? The first issue is, what if the delay in filing the return is on account of reasonable cause? The reasonable काही असू शकतं, दप्तर नव्हतं, दप्तर भिजलेलं होतं, पूर आला होता, अकाउंटंट वॉट एव्हर, डाटा करप्ट झाला होता, और ऑडिट वॉज नॉट कम्प्लीटेड अंडर द कोऑपरेटिव्ह सोसायटीज ऍक्ट, अँड इफ द ऑडिट वॉज नॉट कम्प्लीटेड वी कुड नॉट हॅव फाइल्ड द रिटर्न. वेदर द रिजनेबल कॉज आर्ग्युमेंट विल एनी वे होल्ड गुड, द आन्सर इज क्लिअर नो. द आन्सर इज नो. असं कुठल्याही प्रकारचं आर्ग्युमेंट आपल्याला घेता येणार नाही किंवा त्या आर्ग्युमेंटचा आपल्याला काही फायदा मिळू शकेल असं आत्ताची तरी कायद्याची रचना किंवा अर्थ शब्दरचना कायद्यामध्ये नाही. द नेक्स्ट इश्यू इज, कॅन यू गो इन फॉर द कंडोनेशन ऑफ डिले? द आन्सर इज येस, बट द डिले कंडोनेशन ऑफ डिले पॉवर्स आर ओनली विथ द सिबिडिटी, अँड आय हॅव माय ओन डाऊट दॅट इवन इफ द डिले इज कंडोन्ड, वेदर can you set to be fulfilled in the condition of section 139(1), because you were to file the return, you are not filed the return by say 30th September or 31st of October, you filed the return thereafter and you want to condone the get the delay condone. First of all, people ask me, we already filed the return and we have received the intimation, now can we go for condonation? The answer is no. You already filed the return, where is the question of condonation? But you are yet to file the return and you want to go for condonation. Even if the ITAT the CBDT condones the delay in filing the return, the question again comes up, are you eligible for deduction under section ATP because of the section 80C? Because 80C specifically says that you must file the return before the due date of 139(1). In any case, you have not filed the return before 139 due date, and even after the condonation, the doubt remains whether you are eligible for a deduction under section ATP. But these two things negative, there is one thing positive, which I think atta ja kai notices yet ahet tya sagle ATP kadne yet ahet and tya yet ahet 143(1) madhe processing on prima facie adjustment hone yet. So whether Is it possible for the CPC to deny the deduction in 143(1) processing? Now, I have in front of us on the screen, what are the possible adjustment for CPC under section 143(1). Arithmetical error, no question. An incorrect claim, if such incorrect claim is apparent from any information in the return. Now, this cannot be called to be incorrect claim. Disallowance of loss, upon the disallowance of expenditure, but I highlight clause Roman small 5. Let us read that. It says that disallowance of deduction claimed under section, various sections, ATIA, ATIAB, ATIB, ATIC, ATID, or section ATIE, if the return is furnished beyond the due date specified under section, under subsection 1 of section 139(1). याच्यामध्ये सेक्शन 80AC चा उल्लेख कुठे नाही आहे. सेक्शन 80AC, दिस सेक्शन इज नॉट मेन्शन्ड इन दिस 143(1A) ॲडजस्टमेंट प्रोपोजिशन्स. सो माय आर्ग्युमेंट इज येस, आय मे बी नॉट इलिजिबल फॉर डिडक्शन अंडर सेक्शन 80P बिकॉज माय रिटर्न इज लेट, बट कॅन दी ॲडजस्टमेंट बी मेड अंडर सेक्शन 143(1A)? According to me, there is the adjustment made by the CPC by denying deduction under section 80P for the Patasamsthas or other cooperative society whose returns are delayed is beyond the scope of 143(1A). It is not within their powers, at least as of now, in the sense as the law stands today, because there is very specific wording. And in specific wording, when there is a specific word says general comparison, you have to go to the specific. And in the absence of a specific provision, when the provision is there for many other sections, but not for section 80AC, I suppose the scope of CPC in processing the returns under section 143(1A) is not extended to or extendable to deny deduction of section 80P by applying the section of 80AC in the absence of specific mention of section 80AC in section 143(1). So at least on that count, you can challenge 143(1A) intimations, and thereafter we can see. But as of now, we don't have any precedent because the law which has changed is very recent one, 2018-19 assessment year onwards it has come. And therefore, as of now, there is no precedent that is available which can be shared. But yes, this is an argument which can be made. If not anything else, at least we have this hope, and we can accordingly keep on contesting the CPC intimations under section 143(1A) before the CIT appeals, taking this argument. With this, I stop here. Whatever the topics or issues which are given to me for discussion, I suppose I have dealt with them, but if there are any queries, I'll be happy to deal with those queries. Thank you once again to Shilpa Shingare Madam for giving me this opportunity, and thank you all the participants for listening to me. Thank you so much. Yeah, over to you, Madam.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. It was a wonderful presentation. Rather than going into the section wise, typical technical reading, whatever we, normally we see, you have taken the issues and implications, and it was to the point. Jata sagana dukta hai te sagya section tumhi touch upon kele.
Yes.
It is something we need to appreciate. It was a wonderful presentation. Ani chhan zala tumcha. Tar ata apan kay karuya, ek char paanch prashna je aalele ahet, questions je ahet, te questions apan gheuya.
Okay.
And then already we are, time is up. So some 4-5 questions which I have received. Now, yes. One question which is like 194 amendment to 194A and TDS part of it, right? 50 crores and so.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
15G clarified that, 15G anyway we cannot give. But yes, there are banks or they are asking form 13A, that is lower deduction certificate from Patasamsthas.
Yes, yes.
So
yes.
Please first call on that.
Yes. That is the only option available for the Patasamsthas to reduce the quantum of locking of working capital in the TDS. In fact, it is advice given to all the cooperative Patasamsthas whose deposits are with big cooperative banks, because they are going to suffer TDS from both 194N possibly and also 194A. So the only option is filing application under form by filing form 13A online and obtaining low deduction or no deduction certificate from the cooperative bank from the income tax department. Yeah.
Yeah, but then obtaining, I mean, online, that is not so easily we'll get it. And due to this COVID, there would be difficulty because department is not working. But that 13A can.
Yes, that is possible. Form 13 is for definitely possible for all. Yes.
Okay. Next question is even Sunil Nagaokar sir ana prashna vicharla. Sunil sir, just hold on. Amala je mail var question aale that we are taking. Then employees credit society cha to surplus asto. To concept of mutuality khali exempt ahe ka ata hai. Mothe discuss karayla actually, but simply you can answer. Employees credit society, there is plus, so whether that surplus is exempt under concept of mutuality?
Definitely yes. In my opinion, definitely yes. 101% yes. If your dealings are only with the members, definitely yes. There is no problem. Definitely you can argue. I mean, if you are an employees cooperative credit society, first of all, ATP 2A1 is not a problem at all.
Right.
Because you are otherwise going to get the entire income exempt. Right.
Yeah.
Then the argument comes of mutuality. But definitely because see, you are an association of employees of a particular organization and dealing is with exactly within the members only. You are like a club, you know, a limited limited section of public, and you are dealing with each other. So no one can earn from himself, and that concept of mutuality definitely available. The problem is because there are Supreme Court decision of Bangalore club or Ranchi club where it has been held that third party income, like that you are earning, you are a cooperative credit society, so you are earning income on investments also, which is not from the members. So there is an income which is generated on also from the members and also from outsiders. Now with respect to the income which is earned on the investment, which comes from cooperative banks or other banks, for that you definitely have to go for Section 80P. And therefore my advice would be, you have an argument for making a claim of mutuality, but by that you cannot stop from filing the return. It would be as viable for you to continue to file the return, claim ATP 2A1. Simultaneously, you can make the argument of mutuality, because interest income earned from others, investment, that will not be eligible for mutuality exemption. Yeah.
Right. Okay. The next question is whether tax audit is applicable to employees credit society. Of course, that is applicable, but you can give your version.
Yeah, certainly. If you exceed the limit of 1 crore rupees, tax audit will certainly be applicable to employees cooperative credit society as well. There is no specific exemption. Yeah.
Yeah. Then credit societies ATP is to be claimed under ATP 2C or ATP 2D. A question actually, malapan need kala nahi, but mail varthi asa zalela
hai. Acha, ha. Credit society mantha hai, na the?
Credit society.
Credit society asel tar ATP 2A1 madhe jayla paije. Ani, I mean, if you are a credit society, that means you are giving credit facility to your members. And if that is the case, then you are giving ATP 2A1 is your basic question, basic exemption section. Ani, tyachyamadhye jar basat nasel, tyachyamadhye je kay shillak rahat asel, tar te ATP 2D madhye ghayla paije. ATP 2C he ATP 2A1 madhye basat nahi, ATP 2D madhye basat nahi, kya itar kutlya section madhye basat nasel, tar 2C madhye ghayla. So ATP 2A1 or D, ATP 2D.
Right. Then one question is whether income tax provision should be made by the credit society or not.
Income tax provision has to be made if we as a chartered accountant, when we are auditing, aplyala accounting standards, if they are not applicable to the society, we are bound by the accounting standards of the institute as members, and we have to comment on it. If they do not make the provision, we'll have to comment. And if the accounting standards have to be followed by the society, the provision has to be made in the books of accounts. Yes.
Okay. Then the question is, what is the tax planning for credit societies or banks for years to come? Now,
tax planning.
Since this 194A may, or maybe 115 BAD. So, what is the tax planning we can suggest, maybe in nutshell, for the credit societies or to the banks?
Now, cooperative banks definitely
115 BAD मी सुरुवातीला सांगितलं की यू मस्ट जम्प ऑन 115 BAD, देर इज नो अदर ऑप्शन. सो स्ट्रेट अवे अबाउट 5-6% सेविंग इफ युअर इन्कम इज लेस दॅन 1 crore रुपीज, अँड इफ युअर इन्कम इज मोर दॅन 1 crore रुपीज सेविंग इज अप 8% और लिटल मोर. सो कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँकेसाठी 115 BAD हा ऑप्शन आहे, आणि त्यानंतर 36-17 ची डिडक्शन, 36-18 ची डिडक्शन आणि इन्व्हेस्टमेंटच्या ज्या काही डिडक्शन तुम्हाला घेता येतील त्या या सगळ्या डिडक्शन तुम्हाला जास्तीत जास्त कशा घेता येतील याचं प्लॅनिंग तुम्ही त्या त्या वर्षी केलं पाहिजे. अँड अकॉर्डिंगली यू मस्ट ड्रॉ युअर प्रॉफिट अँड लॉस अकाउंट बॅलन्स शीट ऍट द इयर एंड, अँड यू कॅन अकॉर्डिंगली प्लॅन टू रिड्यूस युअर टॅक्स लायबिलिटी. सो फार एज अदर कोऑपरेटिव्ह सोसायटीज आर कन्सर्न, मस्ट सी ki whether you fall in which subsection of section 80p, and in that case your entire income is exempt. If not, then at least try to calculate the income after claiming whatever possible deduction and try to reduce your taxable portion of income. If it is taxable, then you have to compare yourself with the regular income tax versus 115 BAD. पण मला असं वाटतं ज्यांचं इन्कम टॅक्सेबल आहे आणि 80p ज्यांना मिळू शकत नाही त्यांनी 115 BAD साठी जाणं योग्य राहील असं मला वाटतं. Yes.
हा
सर नमस्कार.
नमस्कार सुनील. यस,
प्रश्न असा आहे की 50 कोटीच्या आतल्या नागरी सहकारी बँकांकरिता सोसायटीच्या डिपॉझिटवर टीडीएस होणार नाही असं तुम्ही आता म्हणाल.
येस,
हा तर ते तसं जर असेल ना तर 50 कोटीच्या आतल्या बँका आणि 50 कोटीच्या वरच्या बँका असं डिस्कशन याच्यापूर्वी कधी नव्हतं ते आता होणार. आता पतसंस्थांबद्दल आपण नव्यानं प्रोव्हिजन होते म्हणून आपण एक्सेप्ट केलं की 50 कोटीच्या आतल्या ज्या काही पतसंस्था आहेत त्यांना टीडीएसच्या प्रोव्हिजन मेंबर नॉन मेंबर काय लागणार नाहीत वगैरे वगैरे. 50 कोटीच्या त्यांना लागणार ऍज लाईक बँक, पण मग 50 खालच्या ज्या बँक आहेत त्यांच्या मेंबरच्या बाबतीमध्ये लागू नाही आणि कोऑपरेटिव्ह क्रेडिट सोसायटीच्या बाबतीत लागू आहे असं का?
म्हणजे एक्झम्पशन लागू आहे.
हा एक्झाम, हा म्हणजे त्या कोऑपरेटिव्ह क्रेडिट सोसायटींना टीडीएस म्हणजे काय म्हणणार की 50 कोटीच्या खालच्या बँकांमध्ये पतसंस्थांच्या ठेवी जाणार आता?
हा असं होण्याची शक्यता आहे बिकॉज ऑफ म्हणजे कसं आहे ऍक्ट मध्ये ही अशी प्रोव्हिजन अशा पद्धतीने आलेली आहे ना. 194A(3)(5) मध्ये जे एक्झम्पशन आहे ते एक्झम्पशन 50 कोटीपेक्षा जास्त ग्रॉस रिसिप्ट असणाऱ्या बँकांच्या साठीच बँका नाही सगळ्या सोसायटीसाठी ते विड्रॉ केलेलं आहे. वेदर युअर कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक ऑर युअर एनी अदर कोऑपरेटिव्ह सोसायटी लाईक से शुगर फॅक्टरी आहे किंवा तुमची स्पिनिंग मिल आहे, तुमचा जर टर्नओव्हर 50 कोटीच्या वर असेल तर तुम्हाला 194A(3)(5) खाली जे एक्झम्पशन होतं. आता 194A(3)(5) खाली एक्झम्पशन कोणासाठी होतं? टीडीएस पेड सॉरी इंटरेस्ट टू मेंबर टीडीएस लागत नव्हता, इंटरेस्ट पेड टू अदर कोऑपरेटिव्ह सोसायटी टीडीएस लागत नव्हता.
बरोबर,
हे एक्झम्पशनच 50 कोटीवर किंवा मोठ्या संस्थांसाठी त्यांनी काढून टाकलेलं आहे. आता हे कसं आहे प्रश्न असा येईल की असे 2 क्लास सरकारला करता येतात का आणि वेदर दिस विल बी अगेन्स्ट द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन की म्हणजे आम्हाला अशी वेगळी वागणूक किंवा आपण म्हणतो ना त्याला प्रेज्युडिशियल वागणूक आम्हाला दिली जाते. म्हणजे मोठ्या बँका असं क्लेम करू शकतात की वी विल बी फार लेस कॉम्पिटिटिव्ह अगेन्स्ट दी स्मॉलर बँक बिकॉज द डिपॉझिट विल नाऊ शिफ्ट टू द स्मॉलर बँक. हा मेन कन्सर्न आहे कारण कोऑपरेटिव्ह मोठ्या बँकांच्यातल्या टीडीएस हा होणारच आहे आणि लहान बँका मात्र टीडीएस करण्याची आवश्यकता नाही आहे. बट आय सपोज दिस इज अ क्लास इन इट सेल्फ. 50 कोटीच्या वरच्या बँका हा एक क्लास होईल, 50 कोटीच्या खालच्या बँका हा आणखी एक क्लास होईल आणि हे क्लासिफिकेशन इज अलाउड एज पर द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन अँड देअर फोर इट विल बी अ कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल अमेंडमेंट. इट इज नॉट अनकॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल ऑर अल्ट्रा वायरस द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन अशी अमेंडमेंट होईल. मला असं वाटत नाही की दिस कॅन बी चॅलेंज्ड, दिस कॅन बी चॅलेंजेबल. पण हा ही परिस्थिती वस्तुस्थिती आहे, लेट अस ऍक्सेप्ट दिस. पतस बँका ज्या लहान बँका ज्या आहेत त्यांना टीडीएस पतसंस्थांचा करावा लागणार नाही पण मोठ्या बँकांना मात्र हा टीडीएस करावा लागेल. लेट अस ऍक्सेप्ट दिस इज द सिच्युएशन ऑफ द लॉ.
ओके ओके थँक्यू.
फेडरेशनने रिप्रेझेंट करण्यासारख्या या गोष्टी आहेत ऍक्च्युली, पण सुनील त्यांचा पॉइंट व्हॅलिड आहे की शिफ्ट होऊ शकतात एफडीज, सो पॉइंट इज व्हॅलिड. बट तुषार दाबले तुमचा प्रश्न विचारा पटकन. मिस्टर तुषार दाबले तुमचा प्रश्न विचारा.
I think it's muted.
Hello. 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 सर कॉपरेटिव्ह बँकांच्या केसेसमध्ये जेव्हा आपण अकाउंट राईट ऑफ करतो लोन अकाउंट तर तेव्हा आपण ते बीडीडीआर मधून मायनस करून राईट ऑफ करतो
हो
पण इन्कम टॅक्स डिपार्टमेंट त्याला डिडक्शन देत नाही
बरोबर
तर ह्याच्यावर काही केस लॉज किंवा काही डिपार्टमेंटचं इंटरनल सर्क्युलर वगैरे असं आहे का की अलाउड आहे हे राईट ऑफ की नाही
आहे आपण आता मगाशी बघितलं सेक्शन 36(2)(5) मध्ये आपण हे बघितलं की बॅड डेटची जी वजावट आहे ती सेक्शन 36(1)(7) खाली मिळते
बरोबर
आणि 36(2)(5) मध्ये हे स्पेसिफिक कंडिशन आहे की तुम्हाला जर 36(1)(7) ची बॅड डेटची जर वजावट असेल मागायची असेल आणि तुम्ही 36(1)(7) बीडीडीआर ची डिडक्शन घेणारी संस्था असाल किंवा घेणारा असेसी असाल तर अशा असेसीच्या केसमध्ये पहिल्यांदा बॅड डेट्स हे तुम्ही बीडीडीआर ला डेबिट टाकायला पाहिजेत आणि बीडीआर पेक्षा एक्सेस जर तुमचे बॅड डेट्स असतील तरच तुम्हाला डिडक्शन मिळेल मी एक एक्झाम्पल मग अशी घेतलं होतं बघा आपण बघितलं की 76 लाख माझा ओपनिंग बीडीडीआरचा बॅलन्स आहे 1412 कोटी मी माझा बॅड डेट्स टाकला तर 1412 मधनं 76 वजा करून राहिलेल्या 1336 वरच मला बीडीडी बॅड डेट्सची वजावट मिळेल म्हणजे तू जेवढं बॅड डेट्स माझं बीडीडीआरच्या प्रोव्हिजनच्या बॅलन्स पेक्षा जास्त आहे तेवढ्याचीच वजावट मिळते हे इन्कम टॅक्सच्या सेक्शन 36(2)(5) मध्येच लिहिलेलं असल्यामुळं केस लॉ वगैरे काय असण्याची आवश्यकताच नाही पण अगदी कायदाच क्लिअर आहे की ही डिडक्शन मिळणार नाही जोपर्यंत
माझा एक व्ह्यू असा होता की जेव्हा तुम्ही बीडीडीआरचं डिडक्शन घेता सेक्शन 36 मध्ये तेव्हा तुम्ही 8.5 घेता आतापर्यंत 7.5 घेत होतो म्हणजे मी समजा 100 रुपयाचा बीडीडीआर बनवला तर मला 7.5 मिळत होतं पण राईट ऑफ करताना मी पूर्ण 100 राईट ऑफ करतोय
नाही 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 असं नाही सर 7.5% हे तुमच्या टोटल इन्कमच्या आहे
म्हणजे बरोबर आहे
हा म्हणजे तुमचा बीडीडीआर जर समजा आता तुमचा जर 7.5% म्हणजे 7.5 रुपये जर समजा झाले असेल हा सर हे तुमच्या टोटल इन्कमचे 7.5 रुपये झाले बॅड डेट्सचा त्याच्याशी संबंध नाही तुमचं टोटल इन्कम म्हणजे तुम्हाला मिळालेला नफा किती आहे त्याच्या 7.5% काढलं जातं त्याचा आणि बॅड डेटच्या अमाऊंटचा काही संबंध नाही अर्थार्थी तुम्हाला तुलना करायची आहे ती बॅड डेट्सच्या अमाऊंटची आलं का लक्षात अरे एम आय क्लिअर
ठीक आहे
महेश पाटणकर तुमचा प्रश्न विचारा
येस हॅलो
सर
आपण टॅक्स ऑडिटच्या साठी लिमिट टर्नओव्हरची आपण नेहमी गृहित धरतो आणि सगळ्या कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक कोऑपरेटिव्ह सोसायटी साठी आपण पीएनएल क्रेडिट साइड घेतो दॅट इज ग्रॉस रिसीट्स
करेक्ट
टर्नओव्हर आपण जेव्हा इंटरप्रिट करतो कमर्शियल कन्सर्न साठी तेव्हा टर्नओव्हर आपण परचेस आणि सेल्स हे गृहित धरतो
बरोबर
कदाचित असं जर इंटरप्रिटेशन झालं की टर्नओव्हर ऑफ क्रेडिट सोसायटीज म्हणजे सेल ऑफ लोन्स किंवा परचेस ऑफ डिपॉझिट्स तर वुड द व्ह्यू इट विल बी डिफरंट सगळ्यांनाच म्हणजे टॅक्स ऑडिट अप्लिकेबल होईल
टॅक्स ऑडिट पेक्षा टीडीएस प्रॉब्लेम होईल त्याचा
टीडीएस पण प्रॉब्लेम होईल दोन्ही होईल
सगळ्यात मोठा प्रॉब्लेम टीडीएस होईल
डिपॉझिट आणि लोन्स 1 कोटी ही इतकी किरकोळ रक्कम आहे की ऑल विल फॉल इन टॅक्स ऑडिट ऑल्सो
पण आय एम क्लिअर ऑन दिस किंवा लॉ इज ऑल्सो अब्सोल्युटली क्लिअर ऑन दिस की आपण म्हटलं की परचेस आणि सेल ऍक्च्युअली सेल हा कन्सेप्ट आहे टर्नओव्हर हा कन्सेप्ट आहे किंवा ग्रॉस रिसीट हा कन्सेप्ट आहे तीन शब्द वापरलेत सेल ग्रॉस रिसीट्स किंवा टर्नओव्हर आता तुम्ही जर हे बघितलं तर हे तिन्ही शब्द एकाच कलर मध्ये म्हणजे एजुस्टिम जेनेरेस हा जो एक कन्सेप्ट आहे लॅटिन वर्ड जो आहे एजुस्टिम जेनेरेस म्हणजे हे जर तीन शब्द एका ठिकाणी वापरले असतील तर ते एकमेकाच्या संलग्नपणे आणि एकाच अर्थाने घ्यायला लागतात मग सेल ग्रॉस रिसीट्स आणि तुमचं हे असेल टर्नओव्हर सेल्स टर्नओव्हर ग्रॉस रिसीट्स आता ग्रॉस रिसीट्स ह्या तुमच्या ज्या आहेत किंवा सेल्स आहे किंवा टर्नओव्हर जो आहे तो तुमचं इन्कम म्हणून घ्यायला पाहिजे आणि परचेस ऑफ डिपॉझिट ही इज नॉट द कन्सेप्ट यू टेक डिपॉझिट or you sale of loans it's not a concept of sale of loan manje purchase of deposits is a misnomer sale of loan is also a misnomer neither of these two concepts will be acceptable or will be considered even by the department it has to be essentially what is there on your credit side of profit and loss account tes tumcha turnover asel tes tumcha gross receipts asel tes kiwa tumcha sales asel ata sales kona sa jacha goods madhe goods to trading karto tyala sales cha shabd vaprayta टर्नओव्हर कोणाला
वापरायचा पण बेसिकली टर्नओव्हर मध्ये पीएनएल क्रेडिट साइड आहे असं कुठे एक्सप्लिसिटली लिहिलेलं नाहीये
नाही नाही तुम्ही जर ही व्हॉट आय सजेस्ट यू की तुम्ही जर नाने पालखीवाल्यांची एन ए पालखीवाल्यांची कॉमेंट्री 40B वर जर वाचला 44AB वर जर वाचाल ह्याच्यामध्ये अतिशय विस्तृत विश्लेषण त्यांनी ह्याच्यामध्ये केलेलं आहे आणि यू विल गेट नंबर ऑफ डिसिजन इन फेवर ऑफ व्हॉट आय एम सेईंग नाऊ की डिपॉझिट्स आणि ह्याचा त्याचा कधी संबंध येणार नाही. ग्रॉस रिसिट्स, टर्नओव्हर आणि तुमचं सेल्स एव्हरीथिंग विल बी विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू द क्रेडिट साइड ऑफ द प्रॉफिट अँड लॉस अकाउंट.
ओके 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 थँक यू
सर. एक लास्ट प्रश्न आपण घेतोय ह्याच्यामध्ये जसं आपण एक मिनिट त्यांना स्वतःलाच विचारायचं असेल तर मी त्यांना चान्स देते आणि मग आपण वाईन करूया.
येस ओके
गेले ते बर. त्यांचा प्रश्न असा आहे की आता जे 194A अमेंडमेंट झाले आणि त्याच्यामुळे TDS कापणार तर आता हा हाऊसिंग सोसायटीशी रिलेटेड आहे. हाऊसिंग सोसायट्यांचं FD ज्यांच्या कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँकेत आहे दॅट मीन्स त्यांचा सगळ्यांनाच बाय डिफॉल्ट कारण ATP 2D खाली डिडक्शन घेतलं जाईल. सो आयडियली ऑल दी हाऊसिंग सोसायटीज दे विल हॅव ह्यूज रिफंड
राईट.
सो ह्याच्यावरती तुमचं काय ओपिनियन आहे?
याच्यावरती पहिला सल्ला असा राहील की इफ दे कॅन अफोर्ड टू शिफ्ट देअर डिपॉझिट फ्रॉम लार्ज कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक टू स्मॉल कोऑपरेटिव्ह बँक थिंग्स विल बी व्हेरी सिम्पल फॉर देम. नेक्स्ट इज दे कॅन अप्लाय फॉर फॉर्म 13 अँड ट्राय टू गेट द एक्झम्पशन सर्टिफिकेट फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट फॉर लोअर रिडक्शन ऑर नील रिडक्शन. आणि हे तिन्ही दोन्ही शक्य नाही झालं तर मग वेट फॉर द रिफंड. तिसरा काही चौथा काही ऑप्शन आपल्याला दिसत नाही बिकॉज डेफिनेटली दे विल गेट ATP 2D डेफिनेटली त्यांना मिळणार आहे. कोऑपरेटिव्ह हाऊसिंग सोसायटी कॉन्ट्रीब्युशन मेंबर्स म्युच्युअलिटी वर त्यांना ते डिडक्शन मिळणार आहे. बाहेरचं जे व्याज आहे कॉपरेटिव्ह बँकामध्ये त्यांना ATP 2D मिळणार आहे. त्यामुळे टॅक्स कुठला लागणार नाही त्यांना, रिफंडच मिळणार आहे. पण हा जर टॅक्स गुंतवायचा जर वाचवायचा असेल तर मी सांगितल्याप्रमाणे टू ऑप्शन. फर्स्ट चूज अ प्रॉपर बँक वेअर दे विल नॉट डिडक्ट द TDS. अदरवाइज गो फॉर फॉर्म 13 अंडर 197.
ओके सर, थँक यू सो मच फॉर युअर वंडरफुल प्रेझेंटेशन अँड फॉर ऍड्रेसिंग दी क्वेरीज ऑफ ऑल्सो ऑफ ऑल दी पार्टिसिपेंट्स. खरंच छान वाटलं आणि आय होप दिस सेमिनार वुड बी ऑफ ऑर वेबिनार वुड बी ऑफ बेनिफिट टू ऑल दी पार्टिसिपेंट्स ऑल्सो. आणि असंच आम्हाला तुमचं मतामध्ये मार्गदर्शन मिळू द्या. तुम्ही छान व्हॉट आय लाईक इज तुम्ही ते असे इश्यूज आणि इम्प्लिकेशन घेता, म्हणजे स्टीरिओटाईपचे अशा सेक्शनचं रिडिंग नाहीये, त्याच्यामुळे इश्यूज पण कळतात आणि त्याचे कॉन्सिक्वेन्सेस आणि गोईंग फॉरवर्ड आपण कसं करायला पाहिजे. आणि इट इज वेल सपोर्टेड बाय ऑल दी केस लॉज. सो दॅट इज दी USP ऑफ युअर प्रेझेंटेशन. सो थँक्स फॉर दॅट. आणि तुम्हाला परत परत बोलवत राहू, तुम्ही येत राहा. आणि ऑल दी चार्टर्ड अकाउंटंट्स प्रेझेंट इयर ऑन 22nd June देर इज गोइंग टू बी webinar exclusively on multi-state cooperatives that I am lining up, because I get lot of queries on multi-state cooperatives also. That is again a gray area, right? Whether what is the empanelment process, whether there is a panel, what is the audit report, how the NPA provisions to be made. So 22nd June, that means coming Monday, we are going to have a webinar exclusively on multi-state cooperatives. So I request all the chartered accountants to kindly attend that seminar. I will send the invite. You will receive it on WhatsApp and email, right? And this program we have recorded, so this recording will be available on my YouTube channel, that is Sahakar Viswa. सहकार विश्व VISW आहे. तुम्ही गुगलवरती नुसतं CA शिल्पा शिंगारे युट्यूब चॅनल किंवा सहकार विश्व टाईप केलं की तुम्हाला माझे सगळे व्हिडिओज मिळतील. हा व्हिडिओ आपण तिकडे अपलोड करणार आहोत आता जे रेकॉर्डिंग केलंय. अँड थँक्स एव्हरीबडी फॉर जॉईनिंग. आणि सर थँक्यू सो मच.
थँक्यू
फॉर कमिंग.
ओके थँक्यू. थँक्यू.